Hello, and thank you very much for tuning in. I'd like to thank the Libre Graphics Meeting for organizing this conference and moving it online. I'm really delighted to be here. I've been wanting to meet and interact with this community for years. I feel at home here. I'm a practicing designer for 15 plus years, and I've always been paying close attention to software as an important part of my practice. And there is also a feeling of new or noobishness. The last couple of years only in the last couple of years only free software and design have really combined in new and much more concrete ways for me in my practice. I switched to Linux about a year and a half ago, and this culminated in starting my new job last November on CryptPad, which I'm going to talk about today. So CryptPad is an encrypted and open source collaboration suite. It's a collaborative office suite, and we aim to offer similar tools and features as the big platforms, but with privacy as a guiding principle. Everything is encrypted in the user's browser, but you can still collaborate in real time. But the server never sees any of the content. It has literally zero knowledge of any of the contents of the documents. It's made by a French company called XWiki, where I work. It's been public facing since 2016, with a lot of the key features such as Drive, etc., being added in the last couple of years. It's licensed under the AGPL. Which means we have our flagship instance at cryptpad.fr, which is about 30,000 weekly users, active users, but there are also over 400 other instances, at least that we know of. It's funded at the moment mostly through research grants. So at the moment we have projects, specific features that are funded by NLNet Foundation, Next Generation Internet. And we recently received a small seed award from Mozilla Open Source Support. Our goal is to become sustainable from user subscriptions only within the next couple of years. We've seen a huge growth in usage since the COVID-19 pandemic. We had about 14,000 weekly users in February, and that went up to 50 during the lockdown, and then now it's settled back down at about between 30 and 40,000. So I'll give you a quick tour. We have a drive to organize your files and your content and to share folders. We have a rich text editor, which is an integration of a CK editor, where we've recently added comments functionality. We have code pads or markdown pads, where you can write markdown. We're integrating a CK editor and making a preview with marked JS. Here we've recently added a color by author for all the Etherpad fan requested feature. We have spreadsheets, which are integrated from OnlyOffice using our encrypted real-time collaboration. Kanban boards, which I recently redesigned, and this is using JKanban. And building on that, we have slides similar to Markdown using CK Editor and Marked, where you can write your slide decks in Markdown. This is what I'm using to present. We have a whiteboard using Fabric.js. And polls, which is due for an imminent redesign in the next few months. So my role started as a designer in November 2019. I've joined the existing team of mainly three. So Aaron McSween is the project lead. Jan Flory is a privacy engineer. We get the occasional support with marketing and promotion, but also with the code itself from Ludovic Dubost, who's the XWiki CEO. I was brought on to basically improve the usability, quote unquote UI UX. I was particularly interested in communicating the trade-offs of the platform. So as I get into, there's a few things that are different from what people, users of Google Drive or Office 365 may be used to. We think it's for good reasons, but the UI needs to reflect some of the quirks. And overall, to improve visual communication, CryptPad has been without a designer since the start. And I think part of what I want to do is have a visual identity that does justice to the project and allows it to stand alongside bigger projects with many more resources in terms of communication and looks. A lot of what I've been doing so far is basically getting to grips with what was already there. And consolidating it, so making the existing language more coherent rather than radically changing things. I've been getting to grips as well with writing for product, so we're doing our own translations are on Weblate, and the role of language is something I may have underestimated, but I'm doing a lot of writing for interface. And recently as well, I've been trained, or like at least introduced to questions of accessibility. And so this is something I'm gonna be watching out for across the platform as well, with the goal to make everything at least AA in the next year or so. So I'm going to run through a few recent features that might give you a sense of the work I've been doing, and also, as I was mentioning, the kind of peculiarities of CryptPad. So the first thing is this functionality called burn after reading, or at least that's what we called it internally. This is the ability to share a document and to force the recipient to delete once it's been opened for the first time. And so while we sometimes look to Google Drive to see how they do things and what our users might be used to or recognize, this is something that doesn't exist, at least to my knowledge, on any other platform. So it was a real challenge to communicate what was going to happen. So we've opted for basically messaging that's attempts to, you know, use words like self-destruct and things like that to really make it clear that this is not a drill. This is what the recipient sees when they receive the pad. So once again, self-destruct, and then giving the option to come back at a later time if you're not ready to proceed. And then communicating that the pad's been deleted from the server once it's been opened. Another key feature I've worked on is the introduction of access lists. So we had a few requests to manage access and revoke access especially. This wasn't possible on CryptPad because if you sent the link to someone, the keys are in the link. So once someone had the link, they basically could not, you basically could not revoke the access. But so with this feature, this adds a layer of granularity to the way that access is managed. So even if someone has the keys to your document, you can add a list to further restrict who can view and who can edit. So it can be used in effect for the use case where you'd want to revoke access to a pad. And so we took this opportunity to group different functionalities together. We grouped it with the notion of ownership, which is really key on CryptPad. Owning a document or a pad is gives you a lot of power, basically. You're the only one that's allowed to delete the document, but also to manage and remove other owners, and also to add the access list, as I've just mentioned. So this was part of a move on my part to consolidate and to try and make these really key but sometimes or unclear features into one notion. So in this case, access. And so the two key things going forward will be grouped under share for the links and the sharing with the CryptPad contacts, and access for managing all this kind of granular permission stuff. The third feature I want to show is this deleting history option. So basically, because of the way that CryptPad works, which is with an append-only log, the longer, the older the document, the larger its history, and that increases its size. And so for a platform that's only our only limitation is storage space. So at the moment we offer a gigabyte of free space for any registered account, and then our subscription plans are basically only adding storage. All the features are the same. So we thought it was a good idea to allow people to clear the history. Basically, the way that we build the history is that every so often we make a checkpoint, so we don't have to recreate the whole history every time you open the pad. So there is a bunch of history that effectively could be trimmed. With this, we introduce a little UI touch, which is a confirm button, and this is, I think, for me, the kind of finer details that's going to help avoid mistakes and make things a bit clearer across the board, while keeping a language that's consistent with what was already there. So in terms of how we get things done, coming back to the theme of the conference, obviously we live in CryptPad, so this we it's our product, but it's also our daily work environment. So we're constantly confronted with our work and our mistakes. In terms of introducing design to this, I've tried to kind of bend the platform to and to find search for ways and workflows and strategies to publish and share design mock-ups. So one thing that I'm commonly doing now is dropping images into a code pad, and then this gets annotated and commented on as we go, and then Jan draws directly from this as he implements things into the code, or I might try and implement something as well. Something that is quite interesting, especially at the start, is that obviously all the a lot of the styles are available. The CryptPad styles are available if you are treating the CodePad like an HTML for HTML markup. So I'm also doing mockups directly in the pad as a kind of way to avoid redrawing the results of HTML, which is something I already hate doing. So writing markup directly and then having a lightweight style sheet at the bottom of the pad has been a nice and quick way to mock things up. And so I guess for me, more generally, it's been about finding some kind of sweet spot between engaging directly with the code base, which is something I'm doing and something I want to do more of, but not always the most efficient way of going about things. And then using Figma to sketch new possibilities and come up with new changes, etc. So I found that although I'm committing some small things directly to the code base and wanting to do that more and more, in terms of design, there is kind of a trade-off between being in the direct contact with the code and learning that curve. But effectively, the end result of that route is that you're just able to reproduce how things currently work. And so on the other side, you have tools like Figma that where you're redrawing pictures of HTML, which is also highly unsatisfactory, but is maybe more conducive to having radically new ideas or concepts that improve the platform. And so I'm aware that uttering the word Figma in the context that we're in is probably like highly heretic. And this has been the conflict for me since the start. And something I really want to pay attention to is that, yes, I want to use only free software in my free software job. That is the ideal. But at the moment, using Figma is basically making the open source software that I'm working on better. And I think this is because the landscape of kind of UX design tools, especially on Linux, is pretty dire. I mean, it's pretty much a desert at the moment. But I'm really looking forward to some super exciting projects on the hopefully near horizon that will help to change this. So I'm watching Akira UX very closely. This is a sketch alternative on GTK, and it's looking like they're gonna have an alpha very soon. And I was also super excited by the FOSDEM demo of a UX box, which looks like an open source Figma killer. So these two projects, I'm kind of refreshing GitHub eagerly to get to try their alpha versions. But there is something I think beyond that, because even if these projects come to their first release, which no doubt they will do, and I'm really looking forward to them, they will still be about drawing pictures of HTML, which is somewhat unsatisfactory. And I wonder if there are other routes where we could more tightly integrate a design tool with the code base. So something along the lines of CraftJS. CraftJS is a kind of component-based page editor, which takes a library from a code base and kind of mixes in these more visual ways of designing. This is for React, which for me it doesn't work because we don't use React. The CryptPad is vanilla JavaScript, but it's making me think about the potential intersection and closer integration between a design tool and a code base that I think would be super interesting, and I want to really look at that as part of my work in the coming years, and to contribute, you know, on this front as well, not just on the open source product itself, but also on how to design for the open source product. So to close, I just wanted to give you a quick preview of a new UI improvement that may or may not be released before this gets streamed to you. If not, it'll be soon after. Basically, a whole overhaul of the toolbars across CryptPad, where I've surfaced a lot of hidden functionality, and also really centered those share and access buttons, as you may be able to see on the slides here. So this is something I'm really excited about, and will be followed soon after by closer visual and the static pages as well. So thank you very much for listening. Here is a bunch of ways to get in touch with us. We're on GitHub, on Mastodon. We have a Matrix chat channel if you have any questions, or if you are thinking about setting up an instance yourself. We're on Twitter as well, for those who still use that. And then my personal details are also here if you want to get in touch. Thank you very much, and I look forward to the questions and discussions coming out of this. Thanks.
Yes. Yeah, so no, we're in terms of myself, himself question. Wait, let me just turn off VLC. I don't know if that's the reason why I'm here myself. Is CryptPad profitable? Already profitable or past the break-even point? We are fully funded by research projects. So as I mentioned, at the moment, this is NLNet Foundation, Next Generation Internet, and a little bit from MOS, Mozilla. But so we're not making profit, we're fully funded. Our goal is to shift the income stream from these grants to being fully funded by our subscribing users, and we're hoping to do that in the next 2 years. At least that's our goal at the moment. Myself, himself, not well understood. Do you plan to embed a UX tool inside of CryptPad? UX designers are not, I don't think, the main target. I think I'm more talking about something that would be, I don't know, to think about the workflow of designing CryptPad, whether that's something that plugs into the code base somehow. I have no concrete ideas about this at the moment. It's just pointing forward something I want to think about, but I doubt that it will be a CryptPad app. The question, is it possible to have my own server with CryptPad? To have your own CryptPad instance? Yeah, absolutely, at the moment. There are about 400 plus instances aside from R1, which is the main one at CryptPad.fr. I haven't set this up myself. We use a lot of safety features like content security policies and stuff like that. So I think the setup is a little bit tricky. But we currently have funding for documentation, which is a big lacking point at the moment. So we're currently working on user documentation, but also admin and install documentation. So we're hoping that will get easier to do within the next couple of months. But yes, absolutely, you can set up your own instance. One of the key features in closed source alternatives is the ability to move from offline tools to online editing and back and forth. How is CryptPad in these terms? And related to this, can nodes communicate with each other? And if yes, how do you work with the challenge of making a decentralized system intuitive from a UX perspective? Okay, lots of stuff in there. So the first question basically relates to import and export. And particularly, I think for a lot of people, it's important to have import and export from Office formats. We have XLSX exports from our sheets, which I think is currently only working in Chrome because of some reason that I forget, but Firefox hasn't implemented something that Chrome has. And we're currently working at the moment on doc or docx export from the rich text. So yeah, we're a bit lacking still on this interoperability, but hoping to bridge that gap fairly soon. And then the instances cannot communicate with each other at the moment, but this is something, so basically federation is something that we're thinking about and might look at in the next, I would say, in terms of the next couple of years, in terms of roadmap. And yes, once we do that, there will be huge UX challenges in terms of making that understandable or intuitive. Any opinion to share about WebRTC? Is this reliable enough for peer-to-peer stream? So I'm not... This is not really my expertise. So you're talking about making this peer-to-peer. I think that would be interesting. We saw the FOSDEM, Ludovic's presentation at FOSDEM was right after YJS as well, which, you know, we discussed doing that peer-to-peer. That's not the current architecture. We do have a lightweight server at the moment, which handles the basically the syncing of encrypted patches. But yeah, I think that's, it's definitely not out of topic. It's interesting, but I can't tell you much more about that. Who are the most users of CryptPad, students, companies, what countries? So on CryptPad.fr, the more than half of our user base is from Germany. And from the support tickets that we get, it seems to be a lot of students and teachers. The German Pirate Party have an instance, one of the bigger instances out there that's not our own. And they, I think they handle basically CryptPad is, we translate CryptPad in French and English, and German translation happen almost instantly. And they, I think they're handling that. So Germany is a big user pool, basically. Kanseko, did you try Inkscape 1.0? I've seen people using Blender to design. Yeah, so I've tried Inkscape. I really like that's pretty amazing progress with 1.0 and designing UX using Blender sounds interesting. I've tried it myself. I have used Blender for 3D, but we'd love to know more about that if you have any links. As I mentioned, there was a couple of mistakes in my talk. I said that we were using CK Editor when it should have been Code Mirror, so I've corrected those and put them in my slide deck, which is on CryptPad. Is there anything, any other questions? The new toolbars that I showed at the end, are not on crypto.fr yet, but they should be. The release will be shipped today, I think, at the end of the day. Question: can web dev backends be used for versioning revisions or even Git? Maybe it can, but that's not how we currently do it. We have an append-only log called ChainPad that handles the string of patches that are applied, and handles also all the conflicts, basically, when two people are typing at the same time. Another question, are you full-time? Yes, I'm full-time since November, and we are full-time on CryptPad. We're three people, so it's myself, Aaron McSween, who's the project lead, and Jan Flory, who's the engineer. And so with the three of us, we do everything from replying to support tickets, to writing code, to translations, all of it. Okay, well, yeah, thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in. And I really look forward to the rest of the conference. The lineup looks super interesting, so I'm going to keep listening. Thank you. Have a good day.